This video tells the story of the Melville family from 1850 to the present. It's based on genealogical research performed on behalf of Tudor Melville by Don Griffith. Enjoy. The earliest known Melville ancestor was Robert Melville, born about 1850 at St. Vincent in the British West Indies. Robert's wife was Ada Boddington, born about 1856. We don't know much about Robert and Ada, and the little we do know comes from official documents pertaining to their children. For instance, when one of Robert's sons emigrated from St. Vincent, the ship's passenger manifest listed the son's nearest relative as Robert Melville of Leu, St. Vincent. From similar records, we know that Ada had a sister in St. Vincent named Jane Boddington. In a story told by Robert and Ada's granddaughter, Lillian Robertson, in 2000, we learn that Robert's middle name was Hadman and that he was of Scottish descent. Both he and Ada were born in the town of Leu in St. Vincent. Lillian said that Ada Boddington's mother was named Mopsy. The Melvilles lived on the island of St. Vincent, the largest island in the country of St. Vincent and the Grenadines. Once a French colony, St. Vincent became part of the British West Indies in the 1760s, making Robert and his family British citizens. Robert and Ada had four children, all born on St. Vincent. Henry Hadman Melville, the oldest child, was born on May 19, 1880. Tudor's grandfather, Thomas Alexander Melville, was born April 4, 1885. Robert and Ada's only daughter was Dora Melville. She was born June 16, 1888. The fourth and youngest child was MacLeod Melville, born March 15, 1894. According to the story told by Lillian Robertson, Ada Melville died in the late 1890s. She would have been about 40. And that left Ada's mother, Mopsy, to raise the four children. Unfortunately, not much is known about Robert Melville after this, except that he was evidently living in Leu, St. Vincent, in 1912. The economy of St. Vincent was based mainly on agriculture. Cotton, coffee, cocoa, and especially sugar had been cultivated on plantations there since the 1600s. In the last decades of the 19th century, competition from European sugar beet farmers caused a collapse of the St. Vincent economy. The resulting waves of unemployment forced many residents to emigrate to find jobs. All of Robert and Ada's children emigrated to the United States. But before we hear about Thomas Alexander Melville and his life in America, we'll spend some time looking at his siblings, Henry, Dora, and MacLeod. The first of the siblings to emigrate was the oldest, Henry Hadman Melville. Henry entered the U.S. by way of Canada in 1908 and settled in the Harlem section of New York City. He lived the rest of his life there, raising a family and eventually owning his own home on West 142nd Street. In 1917, at the age of 36, Henry traveled back to St. Vincent and married 27-year-old Ada Marion Fraser. Immediately after the wedding, Henry and Ada boarded the SS Vestris at Barbados and sailed to their new home in America. The newlyweds arrived in New York Harbor on May 16, 1917. Owen Hadman Melville, the first Melville descendant to be born in America, arrived February 3, 1918. Henry and Ada had two more children, Joseph Henry Melville, born January 14, 1921, and Shirley Melville, born on March 14, 1926. Henry became a naturalized citizen in 1939. Henry Melville passed away at the age of 68 on August 23, 1948. He was the oldest of Robert and Ada Melville's children and the first to venture to America in search of opportunity. Dora Melville was Robert and Ada's only daughter. In about 1914, she married William Robertson and had their first child, Lillian Robertson, on December 15, 1915 in St. Vincent. A son named Henry Robertson was born 2 years later. Dora's husband William immigrated to the U.S. in about 1917, while Dora and the children remained in St. Vincent. In 1921, after he had established himself and saved enough money to pay their passage, William sent for Dora and the rest of the family to join him in New York. Traveling with her were her two small children, Lillian and Henry, as well as 7-year-old Leonard and 17-year-old Edna. According to family lore, Leonard was the outchild of Thomas Melville, and Edna was the outchild of his brother Henry. The term outchild referred to children born out of wedlock. Like Henry and Ada before them, Dora and William established themselves in Harlem, where they had 3 more children, Nicholas, Marion, and James, all born in New York during the 1920s. Dora died in Manhattan at the age of 58 on June 24, 1946. McLeod Melville was the youngest child of Robert and Ada Melville. In 1912, at the age of 18, he immigrated to the U.S., not long after his brother Thomas. Like his older brothers, McLeod registered for the World War I draft. Although he later received a notice from his draft board, it doesn't appear that McLeod was ever inducted into the armed services. In 1918, McLeod traveled back to St. Vincent to marry a woman named Maud. He and Maud returned to New York and, like the other Melvilles, settled in Harlem. Little more is known about McLeod's life after this. Thomas Alexander Melville was the second son of Robert and Ada. He was born April 4, 1885, in Richmond on the island of St. Vincent. He grew up with 3 siblings, Henry, Dora, and McLeod. Thomas's mother, Ada, died in about 1895 when he was 9 years old. He and his siblings were raised by their grandmother, Mopsy. Nothing is known about Thomas's younger years. The first record we have for him is when he immigrated to the United States in 1912. He was 26 years old and had traveled to New York aboard the SS Grenada. The passenger manifest showed that he was an unmarried shoemaker from Leux, St. Vincent. He listed his nearest relative as his father, Robert Melville, living in Leux. Thomas paid for his own passage, and he was planning to join his older brother Henry, who lived at 103 East 81st Street in Harlem. According to the passenger list, Thomas was 5'10½" tall, had brown hair, brown eyes, and a fair complexion. Before leaving for America, Thomas evidently fathered a son named Leonard. Leonard was born November 4, 1912 in St. Vincent. Thomas was unmarried, and we don't know who Leonard's mother was, but it appears that Leonard was raised by Thomas's sister, Dora. Sometime before June of 1917, Thomas returned to St. Vincent to wed Marion Auguste Hadaway. The couple returned to the U.S. aboard the SS Waben, arriving in New York on June 27, 1917. Marion's 24-year-old brother, George Hadaway, accompanied them on the voyage. By this time, Thomas had established a residence at 28 West 139th Street in Harlem. Unlike the 1912 trip, Thomas this time listed his closest relative in St. Vincent as his sister Dora. This may mean that his father Robert had passed away sometime between 1912 and 1917. On July 7, 1918, tragedy struck when Thomas's wife Marion died at the age of 26 from lung disease, possibly caused by the 1918 influenza pandemic. The tragedy was compounded by the loss of her unborn child. Marion was 8 months pregnant when she died. In September 1918, Thomas registered for the World War I draft along with several million other men. He was 33 years old and employed as a bellboy at the St. James Hotel on Times Square. Nina Durant was born February 25, 1881 in Montrose, St. Vincent. Her father was William Jones Durant, born about 1865. Family lore says that the Durants were originally from Scotland. Nina had a younger brother named William John Durant, born in 1894. William immigrated to the United States in 1911 and in 1918 married Agnes McElroy. He served in World War I and had a career in law enforcement. William died in New York in 1949. On October 26, 1919, 28-year-old seamstress Nina Durant boarded the SS Uberaba at Barbados and traveled to New York City. Nina paid her own passage and was going to meet her friend Thomas Melville, living in Harlem. On November 6th, just 4 days after she arrived, Nina and Thomas were married in Manhattan. The newlyweds were noted in the 1920 census living at 131 West 137th Street in a rented apartment in Harlem. Thomas had a job as an elevator operator. Thomas and Nina's first child was Tudor Alston Melville, born August 29, 1920 in New York. They went on to have four more children during the 1920s, all born in New York. Errol Melville, born January 6, 1922. Marilyn Evadne Cleo Melville, October 11, 1923. Digby Dolman Melville, September 15, 1925. And Curtis Albin Melville, July 4, 1928. In 1921, before his second child was born, Thomas filed a declaration of intention to become an American citizen. These were sometimes called first papers, since they were the first forms to be completed by new immigrants in the naturalization process. After the immigrant had completed these forms and met the residency requirements, usually several years, the individual was able to submit his petition for naturalization. In August 1925, Thomas filed his petition for naturalization with the U.S. Southern District Court of New York, and on December 10, 1925, Thomas became a U.S. citizen. In June of 1925, the New York State Census showed Thomas and his family living at 207 West 142nd Street in Harlem. Thomas and Nina, along with their children Tudor, Errol, and Marilyn, we're joined by Thomas's 12-year-old son, Leonard. This is the last known record of Leonard Melville, and nothing is known about him beyond the age of 12. In the 1930 census, we discover Thomas, Nina, and their five kids living at 204 West 131st Street, along with seven lodgers. Thomas was still working as an elevator operator, but he now owned his home and presumably collected the rent from the lodgers. The residence was valued at $14,500, equivalent to $200,000 or more in today's dollars. On October 15, 1932, Thomas and Nina's second son, Errol, died in Manhattan. He was only 10 years old. In the 1940 census, the family was still living at 204 West 131st Street. Thomas was an elevator operator, a job he'd been doing now for at least 20 years, and he continued to have rent-paying lodgers. The value of Thomas's home had appreciated and was now worth $17,000. 19-year-old Tudor had a job as a restaurant waiter, and the other children were still in school. In 1940, one of Thomas's neighbors was Ferdinand Morton. Mr. Morton was about the same age as Thomas and had lived for a year or two directly across the street. Ferdinand was a music composer, and while there's no way of knowing if he and Thomas were friends, it would be nice to think so, because Ferdinand was better known as Jelly Roll Morton of ragtime jazz fame. In 1942, 57-year-old Thomas registered for the World War II draft, sometimes referred to as the old man's draft. The purpose of this registration was to collect information on the industrial capacity and skills of men aged 45 to 64. It was never intended for these men to be drafted into military service, but rather to see if their labor skills could be used in the war effort. Thomas's draft registration shows that sometime between April 1940 and April 1942, the family had moved out of Harlem to the borough of Queens at 4514 Utopia Parkway in Flushing. Their three-bedroom, two-bath home was built in 1940, so it's very possible that Thomas bought it new. Tudor Melville was Thomas and Nina's first child, and also the first to get married. On August 16, 1942, 21-year-old Tudor Alston Melville married 23-year-old Mary Angela Santori, the daughter of Silvio and Rosa Santori. At about this same time, Tudor received a draft notice, and on October 20th, just 10 weeks after they were married, Tudor was officially enlisted as a private in the United States Army. While Tudor was in Army training, Mary gave birth to their first child, Errol Whitney Melville, born in 1943. By late 1943, Tudor had been transferred to the Army Air Force and promoted to Staff Sergeant. He joined four enlisted men and four officers aboard a Boeing B-17 Flying Fortress. During combat missions, he was a waist gunner, and his job was to protect the left side of the aircraft from enemy fighters using his 50 caliber machine gun. Tudor's plane was assigned to the 600th Bomb Squadron, part of the 398th Bomb Group. In May of 1944, the 398th began operations at Nuthampstead, England, about 40 miles north of London. Over the next year, the 398th flew 195 bombing missions involving hundreds of aircraft. On August 4th, 1944, Tudor's B-17 was part of a 35-plane bombing sortie headed to Germany. The flight plan called for them to fly out over the North Sea, turn southeast into Germany near Bremen, and from there go on to the target at Brandenburg. Total round trip, about 1,200 miles. That was the plan. Unfortunately for Tudor and his crewmates, the plan changed suddenly and violently. Almost immediately after they crossed the German coastline, their B-17 was struck by anti-aircraft flak. All nine crew members bailed out safely and were captured by German forces within a few hours. A map from the missing aircrew report marks the spot where they went down. Records show that the men were transferred to the Dulagluft camp near Frankfurt, Germany. This was a temporary prison camp for newly captured airmen who were processed, interrogated, and then transferred to permanent camps elsewhere in Germany. At the end of August, Tudor and several of his enlisted crewmates were transferred to Stalag Luft 4 near the modern-day city of Tychów in northern Poland. Stalag Luft 4 was one of the largest camps and held thousands of enlisted airmen. The War Department undoubtedly informed Mary that her husband was missing in action. Later, in December 1944, New York newspapers published a list of POWs that included 63 local men, among them Tudor Melville. Conditions at Stalag Luft 4 were generally bad within the camp, but the infamous Black March was even worse. On February 6, 1945, about 8,000 prisoners from Stalag Luft 4 began an 86-day forced march towards Stalag 11B in the west. The Russians were advancing, and German commanders did not want the prisoners liberated. The Allied prisoners were forced to march hundreds of miles along a zigzagging path meant to avoid the advancing Red Army. Food and water were scarce, and the men subsisted on as little as 700 calories a day. Pneumonia, diphtheria, typhus, trench foot tuberculosis, and other diseases ran unchecked amongst the POWs. An estimated 1,500 men died on the Black March. In April 1945, the prisoners reached Stalag 11B, where many camps from the eastern part of Germany were being combined into one large camp. Army records show that Tudor was at Stalag 11B when the Allies arrived to liberate the camp. By May 1945, he was headed home.
Easily some of the best news coming out of Germany today is the release of more and more Allied prisoners of war. Stalag 11B, which held about 6,500 men, was liberated by the 7th Armored Division, the Desert Rats, and at least 15 Allied nations were represented in the camp.
On June 6, 1945, the Long Island Star published the latest casualty list of New York men killed, wounded, or missing. Thankfully, the last and longest part of that list was a tally of POWs had been liberated, and Tudor's name was there. Tudor returned home in 1945 to a happy reunion with his wife Mary and 2-year-old son Errol. After the war, Tudor introduced his sister Marilyn to fellow Army veteran John Brunaforte. John was in the infantry and had survived his own ordeal in a German prisoner of war camp. Tudor's brothers were also war veterans. Digby Melville enlisted in the U.S. Navy the same week that his older brother was sworn into the Army. Digby was a motor machinist mate assigned to the USS Procyon. This was an attack cargo ship that carried troops, heavy equipment, and supplies in support of amphibious assaults. The Procyon saw action during the invasion of Sicily and southern France, and later in the Battle of Okinawa. Tudor's youngest brother Curtis, too young to fight in World War II, was an Army private during the Korean War. On the morning of August 1, 1946, 1 year after the end of the war, Tudor's father, Thomas, suffered a coronary. It was a Thursday, and Thomas was probably on his way to work. He died at the subway station at 68th Street in Lexington. Thomas was 61. Over the next 10 years, Mary and Tudor's family grew. Errol was joined by 4 brothers and a sister, Thomas Alexander Melville in 1947, Dennis Roger Melville, 1948, Diane Margaret Melville, 1949, Kenneth Joel Melville, 1952, and Tudor Alston Melville in 1956. On August 6, 1952, just 2.5 weeks before Kenneth was born, Tudor's mother, Nina Melville, passed away in East Meadow, New York. Like her husband, Thomas, she was 61 when she died. In September 1953, Tudor and his family lived at 2021 Central Drive South in East Meadow, New York. Tudor worked as a TV repairman. In 1962, Tudor and Mary Melville moved to Arizona and bought a house at 1722 Parkside Drive in Tempe. At that time, their 6 children ranged in age from 6 to 19. A decade later, tragedy struck the Melville family once again. Tudor Melville, father of 6, passed away at the VA hospital on May 6, 1973. Tudor was only 52 years old. His wife Mary survived him almost 30 years, passing away on October 4, 2002. She had 21 grandchildren and 21 great-grandchildren when she died at the age of 83. The story of Robert Melville and Ada Boddington's numerous and diverse descendants doesn't end here. There's still much to learn and discover, and brand new Melville stories are being written every day. From humble beginnings in the little island nation of St. Vincent, your family has thrived and multiplied in America. Melvilles everywhere should be proud of what you and your ancestors have accomplished. This is your host, Don Griffith. It's been my pleasure to present this history to the Melville family. I want to thank Tudor Melville, Diane Waddell, and the whole family for providing information and photographs for this project.